This is Not Just OK TV. The show is Spotlight, and my name is Nosa Morige, also known as Nosa, gospel artist with Chocolate City. Nosa is short for Nosakari, or Nosakari. Yeah. Nosakari is an Edo name. My full name is Nosakari Shedrack Omorege. I'm from Edo State and Delta State. My dad is from Edo State. My mom is from Delta State. I'm a musician currently signed to Chocolate City. My message is on love, God, peace. It's the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's also to promote positive vibes, you know, to inspire people. I studied electrical and electronic engineering in the University of Benin. I think that's basically it. I'm just a very simple person. How I found music? I found music from when I was a child. My family members were in one choir or the other when I was growing up, and it was natural for me to just love to sing because my older siblings, my parents loved to sing. And then I was in a church where everybody wanted to be a perfectionist in music, and if you weren't good, they'd laugh at you. So I just naturally wanted to do music properly, and I became a music lover, and yeah, it's been there from the beginning. The other influences in my music were basically from church, more or less from church, yes. I had different choir masters, I had different choir members. There's a guy really in, I when I was in my late teens and we were in church together, he was my music director then. He really, really, really pushed me. In terms of starting up, I got a lot of support from my father. He was the kind of person that wouldn't stop you from doing whatever you wanted to do, from pursuing whatever you wanted to pursue, as long as you're a success doing it. There were people who were more cautious, you know, thinking being a musician, or then I was a pastor at some point. Being a pastor, a musician, was like failure when you studied electrical engineering, you know. But my father really supported me, some of my siblings really supported me. I'd say like 90% of them supported me. I say them because I come from a polygamous home, so. And yeah, I think I didn't lack in terms of support from my close family members. So, yeah. I Always Pray For You, which was my first single that I released on NotJustOK.com in 2009, and was really massive, and it's still massive till now. I was thinking of making a song. I had an inspiration, so to speak, for a song, and I was just singing, I'm not gonna feed they always pray for you. And I liked how it sounded in my head, and I couldn't wait to get home to just open my laptop and start producing. And after a while, when I was making the music, it was supposed to be a blend of hip hop and soul. I was laying the music down, then I felt I need to make it positive. I felt God telling me, make it positive. No matter what, you should always pray for someone. And so when I was producing and writing, I started seeing all the scenarios where the song would work. You know, departure, maybe people saying goodbye to each other. So I decided, okay, I really should do this, because saying goodbye almost always carries a that emotion of sadness and all. So I said, but since goodbyes are inevitable, we have to make it more bearable. So we have to carry that that emotion and give it a responsibility to pray for the person, to look out for the person's welfare. If I'm a gospel artist or an inspirational artist or both. For me, there's no genre like inspirational music. There's no genre. Actually, they created a genre called gospel music, but it doesn't define what the word gospel really is. It's trying to define a sound, that is heard in church, but it doesn't define what the gospel is. The gospel is not a genre of music, it's a message that carries life to me. So I would say I'm a musician. I cut across many genres sound-wise, and I inspire people with the gospel, and I preach the gospel. So the gospel is meant to inspire. And I know there are some artists who want to cut across, who want a more general audience than just a Christian audience. So they have to find a way to identify themselves, and they call themselves inspirational artists. And I've been called an inspirational singer, and I just, sometimes I go with the flow for the sake of those who may not understand what I'm trying to say. I don't only preach the gospel, I live the gospel. And there are fruits of the gospel, like how I love my neighbor, how I love whoever I'm in a relationship with, how I love my friends, how I love my family. Now, I may not be preaching the gospel directly from with my words, but I'm preaching the gospel, or I'm living the gospel with my lifestyle of forgiveness, of peace, of love, of mercy, of honesty, of what's the word, integrity, you know. I think the words are plenty, the adjectives are plenty. So the role of indigenous gospel artists in the Nigerian music industry, I see it this way. We're not really a part of what is going on in the mainstream. We're not really a part of the industry, as it were, because we try to trap everything in church. So there are more gospel artists, there are more, production-wise, there are more gospel songs out there today than mainstream songs in Nigeria. There's a lot going on, but because we're not really a part of the industry, I use the word we, we're not really a part of the industry, we trap our music in church, we don't have that much effect as we should have. And there is a bias, so to speak, from some sectors of the industry against gospel music. For instance, your songs play on the radio on Sunday when everybody is in church. So who's listening? You know, only on Sundays. Your music is not allowed into the mainstream for whatever reason. So we're not having as much effect as we should have in the mind of the people, because when you place gospel music in the Sunday box, and when you only put gospel music in church, people have that religious mindset that it's supposed to serve some religious purpose, and you cannot party with it, or you can't just enjoy good music by listening to gospel songs. The solution in making gospel music go mainstream in Nigeria is a change of mindset, first of all. I think Nigerians are extra religious. We're so religious that if Jesus came, we would chase him out. If he came, yes, in the flesh, to Nigeria in this our time, we would chase him out because of how religious we are. So I think when we begin to bear responsibility to the people that we are supposed to reach out to, when we begin to have a sense of responsibility to the people, or towards the people that we were originally sent to reach, which is everyone, I think we'll begin to be more effective. And then I think we should have more media support, mainstream media support. But it's going in a certain direction where it's like we need to create our own avenues, we need to create our own platforms for us to be heard. And if we decide to step out, I think there will be more mainstream participation, more mainstream interest. And because it is not just church, we've somehow, one way or the other, we've entered into an industry. There is I think when there is mainstream participation in what we do, we will actually get our messages across through participation in that industry. As a gospel artist in Chocolate City, it's not one house where we come and stay. Everybody, it's a company that is into production, management, promotion, publishing. It's as easy as working as a Christian in your bank, and working in a bank or in a hospital or whatever. You understand that there's something we have in common, and it's to promote our music, you know, produce our music, promote, distribute, you know. So it's not been an issue whatsoever, you know. I've never been told to deviate from what I do. So yes, I don't see any reason why I shouldn't be. I cope well with other artists when we have to work together for any reason, you know. So, well, do I think it is right for a secular artist or a gospel artist to collaborate with a secular artist? First of all, what are you collaborating? What are you producing? What's the collaboration about? You know, that's the key thing. So, for instance, collaboration is a big word. If I can decide that I want my producer, I can work with a producer who does not believe in what I believe in, if he's going to give me what I need. You understand? It's work. What are we producing? Am I doing something that is against what I believe or against what I'm trying to change with my message? That's the issue for me. That's one. Sometimes I say not because of holiness, but because of politics. For me, it depends on the context. It's not entirely wrong, but it depends on the context, you know, so that what I'm trying to do in terms of collaborating with someone is not detrimental to the message I'm trying to pass across. So I have to watch out for that. Whether gospel music pays the bills, it is relative. Just the same way not all secular musicians make money enough from their music. It's the same way. There are people who are, and there are many gospel artists, who are far richer than many of the artists we see out there. But you know, as a Christian, I'm not meant to boast in material things. It's not the message of Christianity. Part of the message of Christianity tells you not to be attached to material things, but get your self-esteem and your joy and happiness from what God has put inside of you. As for whether a gospel artist should honor invitations to secular events, I've gone to a lot of secular events, like weddings, some national gatherings, like government gatherings. I can go there, sing the national anthem or something. So it depends. It depends on... I can't go to an event where something is happening that is against what I believe in. And if I do get there, if I feel it leading to go there, I'm bringing me, I'm bringing what I believe in, I'm bringing my message, I'm bringing the essence I carry, I'm bringing the power I carry. So when I step on a stage, I recently performed at an event and I prayed and I said, hey God, if I'm stepping here and people don't feel you, then there's no need. So it's still about the impact I'm going to make. It's still about the message I'm going to pass across. When should you be expecting another album? Soon and very soon. We're working. There's a lot of work going on. Singles are about to drop soon by the grace of God. So I think you should even go beyond expecting an album. It's albums, different projects. So soon and very soon. The future of gospel music in Africa is looking very, very, very bright. In fact, gospel music if we're going to make business out of it, would do much more than mainstream music. When you talk about longevity, when you talk about relevance, there are gospel songs. Gospel songs never fade, actually. Gospel songs never fade because you never run out of the need for the word of God. You never run out of the need for fellowship. They never fade. They may be old and maybe they may be in the background because of new music, but then they're still relevant. Gospel music being neglected in at award shows and by the awarding associations or organizations is only a reflection of the fact that gospel music is neglected in the industry as a whole. It's not appreciated as a part of the industry, although it is making money. It is generating so much money, maybe because they are not at the marketing end of the industry. The marketers, they should take a trip to Alaba and see, you know, who brings in the most revenue. Top two gospel artists in Nigeria. I won't do top two. They're all at the top. let me be at my Christian desk. They're all at the top. We're all at the top. All of us, we're at the top. We're the head and not the tail. So I won't tell you any top two. Yeah, but yes, there's so many people doing great stuff now. There's Nathaniel Bassi, there's Sinach, there's Frank Edwards, there's Joe Praise, there's Myro SA, my friend. There's Bucci. It's not in any order, any particular. There's my bros, Samuel Kposo. There's Tim Godfrey, Choma Jesus. There's Freke. There's Onos. There's Gloria Brima, that's my sister from another mister. So, yeah. And then sometimes there's Nosa. The top gospel artists outside Nigeria, there are so many. They are all at the top as well. Like Don Moen, Michael W. Smith, Fred Hammond, Marvin Saab. There are groups of musicians. There's Bethel Music, there's Hillsong, there's Jesus Culture. They're all very big. There's Elevation Music, there's Travis Green, if I have not mentioned Travis Green. So there's so many of them. Michael Stampley, so many of them. Donnie McClurkin. Okay, so finally, to all gospel music listeners out there, I want to say there's a lot more coming. There's a lot more coming because I think God has really poured out grace to not just be in your fellowship times, your devotion times, but also in your celebrations, in your grievings. We're going to be a part of everyday life. We're not just doing church music. We're doing music that will cut across, that will be relevant to your everyday life, just as the Word of God is relevant to your everyday life. Yes, 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 yes. It's been your man, N to the O to the S, A, Nosa. So this is me saying goodbye. God bless you. And I go always pray for you. Once again, you're watching Spotlight, Not Just OK TV. Keep watching. Peace.